Hi there. Today we'll be learning about entropy, what it is, and how it's applied on the microscopic scale. Speaking generally, on the macroscopic scale, entropy relates to the exchange of heat and helps to explain why energy is always transferred from a hot body to a cold body. When this happens, the hot body will have an increased entropy because it will now have less heat energy available. At the same time, the entropy will decrease in the cold body because it'll now have more energy available to do work. But this is also intimately related to the ordering and disordering of systems. It may help to think of entropy in this way. Entropy is the level of disorder in a system. The order or disorder of a system is usually a good indicator of the amount of energy available in that system for doing work. High entropy means lots of disorder, and consequently low energy. Low entropy is the opposite, a very neatly ordered system. This is crucial because we need to understand how much energy is available in a system if we hope to use that system to do work. So we need to understand how disordered the system is. Imagine a group of astronauts all inside a spaceship. They each have certain daily duties as well as sleeping and waking patterns. These are so neatly ordered within the system of the spaceship that every astronaut is available to do work at any time. This is a low entropy system because it's very ordered and has a lot of potential energy. Now imagine that a meteor tears a hole in the wall and they all get sucked into the vacuum of space and flung far apart from each other. In this state of disorder, in this huge system, they're unlikely to be able to do any work. But even if we keep the same system, that is, assuming the spaceship stays the same, increasing the level of disorder in the system through, for example, sickness or poor scheduling, also results in less energy being available for work. Left to their own devices, or without confinement, most order, meaning high heat zones, will move to disorder. This is a way of thinking about the second law of thermodynamics. Energy always spreads out. So let's get away from the macroscopic perspective of the astronauts and instead look at how entropy can be illustrated from a microscopic viewpoint. We know that entropy equals disorder. High entropy means more disorder and low entropy means more order. It's crucial to also be aware that this process of systems moving from order towards disorder is irreversible, that is, without an external force. To illustrate this irreversibility, let's imagine a perfectly thermally insulated container with a wall in the middle. One half is filled with an ideal gas, and the other side is a vacuum. If we quickly remove the central wall, the gas expands to fill the entire volume of the container. The molecules fly around the container, and this increase in volume for the same number of atoms increases the possible arrangements, so the disorder increases. When you think about the astronauts flung into space, they become so disordered in the larger volume that they're very unlikely to ever collide with each other again. They're also very unlikely to ever spontaneously bounce back into the spaceship. Similarly, because the gas is in a closed container and is now spread out, you can't put the wall back in and separate the container into the one half containing all the atoms and the other half being a vacuum, like it was when we started. The same thing can be illustrated with ice. When it changes phase from solid to liquid, the molecules in it become more able to freely move around and rearrange. It becomes more disordered. So why don't we just call disorder, disorder? Why make up a fancy-sounding word like entropy? Well, first, because scientists like fancy-sounding words. But second, because they're also helpful. By giving the concept a name, we can turn it into a unit to measure systems by. Let's learn about measuring the change in entropy. A change in entropy is written as delta S, and is equal to the heat flow into a system Q, divided by the temperature T. With the ice, there is no heat flow, so we can use a similar formula, but focus instead on latent heat. This posits that the change in entropy of the ice is equal to the ice's mass, m, multiplied by the latent heat of fusion, divided by the temperature of the ice, T. The unit for entropy is joules inverse Kelvin, or joules per Kelvin. Be aware that an increase in entropy doesn't necessarily arise solely due to heat transfer to a system, because it can also happen through a change in molecular disorder or a phase change within the system. The ice, once melted onto the table, can't refreeze back into a cube. Let's determine the change in entropy of 1 kilogram of ice during its phase change to a liquid at 0 degrees Celsius, or 273 Kelvin. We'll begin by writing the equation for the change in entropy of the ice, the one written in terms of latent heat. The latent heat of fusion for 1 gram of ice at 0 degrees Celsius is 334 joules. So we can determine that we'd need 3.4 times 10 to the 5 joules per kilogram to melt the 1 kilogram block. Let's plug these values into our formula and do the arithmetic, and we will find that the change in entropy of the ice will be 1.2 times 10 to the 3 joules per Kelvin. Hopefully this has made the basic idea of entropy on a microscopic scale much clearer. For more learning material about entropy and other physics fun, be sure to explore the rest of the Chegg website. See you next time!